and welcome to our final day in the Netherlands. It's been such an honour, hasn't it, to be here at this remarkable event and to hear so many powerful stories. This week really has sped by, hasn't it?
Yeah, where has it gone? But today it's the turn of cycling here in the Zuiderpark. We'll be bringing you all the racing action over the next hour. Also coming up a little bit later in the show, see what happened when Prince Harry and I popped out for a walk around the park, and he told me why these games are so important to everyone, whether you've served or not.
But first, let's meet the captain of the UK cycling team, Richie Gray. Now, he's been training really hard for the Games at his home near the breathtaking Cheddar Gorge. It's been a very long journey to The Hague, but the finish line is finally in his sights.
So I was kicked out of school at 17 and joined the Navy, inspired by my grandfather. I became an engineer. And that was my niche, that's where I have my interest. So, you know, you go from being a kid from Berwick who was working in a sausage roll factory to working on a nuclear submarine. It's not too bad. I had to get on board the submarine. It was cold, it was wet. And as I was going down the ladder, I slipped and went from the top to almost the bottom. I grabbed hold of one of the rungs of the ladder with my other arm and wrenched my shoulder out. What appeared to be just a painful shoulder at the time transpired to have torn several ligaments in my shoulder. I went in for an operation. I had my ligaments and tendons in my shoulder reattached, leaving me with impaired movement in my shoulder. I really thought that, you know, I'm Superman, I can get on with anything, nothing's going to faze me, but actually when you are hit with something that does restrict you, then you have to reevaluate your life. Fast forward and slightly to 2017, and I discover that I have bladder cancer. I had the cancer removed. It grew back within 6 months. I had it removed again, and I went in for chemo. Rock bottom was, it's quite a difficult one. Rock bottom was in my camper van, doing the unthinkable, and a bloke called Dave, don't know if that's his real name, but that's what he told me, because he was a homeless guy, opening the door, pulling me out, and sitting down with him for about, 2 hours. And Dave saved me, literally and figuratively. He had a chat and really got into my head. It's the hardest thing to do, is to realise that you need to speak. But it's the biggest relief that you'll ever have once you do. It just takes that reaching out to one person, and that could save a life. If I didn't get the gold medal and everybody else achieved their goals, whether it's a personal best or to finish the race or to even start the race, I would sacrifice it. The medal doesn't matter. To get everybody on that start line, to get them to do their best, to finish and get that sense of achievement, then that is the ultimate goal for Team UK.
Wow.
I think that's one of the most powerful pieces we've seen this week, isn't it?
Dave, if you're out there, thank you for saving one of our brothers. Look after each other, folks.
You okay?
Yeah.
Richie, right. As we heard there, found himself at rock bottom, but it took one person to reach out and talk. Now, we've heard all week just how important it is to have these conversations, especially if you're struggling. So for more information and advice on getting the mental health support that you or somebody you know needs, head to bbc.co.uk/actionline. You can also go to the BBC's Headroom website, bbc.co.uk/headroom, where you'll find lots and lots of brilliant tools that may help you.
Yeah. Well, we will see Richie in the bunch race shortly. But first up, he was in the men's time trial. Richie was one of the first UK riders off the start line this morning. It's a quick one-lap effort to get the blood flowing, and he ended up taking fourth place in the men's IRB3. Also in the category was James Rogers, who's been going really well in training back home. He took the bronze for the first UK cycling medal of the day. It was bronze too for Vicky Wales in the women's recumbent category, with her teammate Denise Kidger coming in fourth. And we'll hear from Vicky later in the programme.
We will. Right then, so after the individual effort of the time trial, let's move on to the bunch races. First of all, the men's IRB 3 featuring Richie Gray and James Rogers, with Paul Inman completing the UK lineup. In the commentary box are Matt Chilton and Invictus Game medalist and Paralympian Steve Arnold.
The men's IRB road race final is underway. 20 riders involved. Three British competitors. We've got Richard Gray for the UK wearing 66, Paul Inman wearing 69, James Rogers for the UK wears 74. Steve Arnold, double Invictus Games gold medalist, is alongside. Welcome, Steve. How do you see this unfolding, and what chances do Gray, Inman and Rogers have here this afternoon?
Yeah, thanks, Matt. They have a great chance, you know, coming off the back of the TT they did this morning, with James Rogers coming away with a bronze, Richard Gray just behind him in fourth, and Paul just outside the top 10. They've got a great chance. They've been training together all year, so I'm sure they've got some tactics and who's going to be the strongest rider to, like, follow them breakaways, and hopefully they can all get around as a team and come away with a couple of medals.
So we'll keep an eye on it. It's a 20-minute race around the park. Pace fairly easy to start with. Three Danish competitors wearing the red and white stripes, easy to spot at the back of the pack. Richard Gray has the pink handlebars. He's also easy to see in the pack. Richard Gray wearing number 66. Halfway through the men's IRB road race final, and all 20 are still bunched together. Just under 10 minutes left in the race, and out in front at the moment, representing the United Kingdom, James Rogers is pushing the pace. Rogers, Inman and Gray all near the front of the field.
Yeah, there's been a couple of little breakaways from the other nations, but they've all been closed down, mostly by James. I just hope he's saving his energy, you know, for the final bit. It's about time he let someone else close the brakes down.
Now Monnier goes for it. Look at him. He's got so much strength and experience. Gerard Monnier looking for his second gold medal of the day. Great move from Gerard Monnier. So far, Richard Gray with the pink bars has got it covered. He's holding on to second or third position at the moment. And the field is well spread all of a sudden.
Yeah, great little move there by the French guy. And first attack got closed down, and he was straight on it, onto another attack, and no one wanted to follow him.
They've taken the bell, and Gerard Monnier is riding high and pushing a big gear as he tries to move clear to secure his second gold medal of the day. It looks like it's Rafał Rączewski of Poland who's holding second position, and one of the Australians is up there as well. Might be Andrew Wilkinson. Richard Gray is not out of this. He's in about fourth position at this stage. That's where he finished in the time trial, so Gray will be desperately keen to get in amongst the medals this afternoon. But what a move from Gerard Monnier, Steve Arnold.
Yeah, great move there. You know, he's done one attack, that got closed down, and he was straight on again into another attack. Got around that bend, got out the saddle, put some power down, and no one could stay with him. Great move. Hopefully the other guys behind him could just work together. Forget about team. They're all split up now. Just them four behind him, work together and try and close this gap.
So at the front of the race, for the second time today, Gerard Monnier is on course for a gold medal, this time in the final of the IRB 3 road race. It was a surprise move from Gerard Monnier. He'd threatened a couple of times during the race. He'd made a couple of little breakaways, but they'd been clawed back in by his competitors. But this move was decisive.
great move there. They've just he's just blown the field apart. There's loads of little groups now. I reckon he's got a good 30, 40 metres on him already.
Just going past James Rogers, who was leading for a while for the United Kingdom. James Rogers and Paul Inman back in the pack. In fact, that's Richard Gray with the pink handlebars. He was in contention for a while as well. But the leader is off down the road now. And here he is at the front of the IRB road race final. The Frenchman, Gérard Monnier, is all on his own in a different league. Chase group here. And there's a bit of jostling for position. A few tactics creeping in as they try to sort the minor places and the medals out for themselves. Number 60, Gérard Monnier, glances over his shoulder, but there's no threat at all.
Yeah, incredible rider. He's gone for it. He's definitely in my eyes, he's got this gold medal in the bag, unless he does get a technical, but I can't see any problems with his bike there. It's just got the guys behind now have just got to battle out for that silver and bronze medal. So it's going to be an exciting finish for this pack here.
Clean track ahead for Gérard Monnier. Meanwhile, a bunch of Australians, a couple of Polish guys, a couple of UK riders in the tussle for silver and bronze. And the applause can start for Gérard Monnier. Two Aussies in there. Number six on the left of screen, that's Ashley Muir. Monnier still pushing hard. He hasn't let up. And he will start to relax and cruise. He's taken something out of his back pocket. I don't know if it's is it a French flag or something. I'm not sure. No, it's a picture of some of his compatriots, I think. A tribute to Max and Brees. Nicely done by Gérard Monnier as he crosses the line for gold. And the silver medal goes to Ashley Muir of Australia, with Kasper Holm Henriksen getting the bronze for Denmark. In fourth, Richard Gray, and James Rogers comes home in fifth. Brilliant finish for this road race here in the park. What a way to complete the final day at the Invictus Games.
That's a decisive move there from Gerard on that corner again. Up about the saddle, nice and fast. Fast arms, fast legs, got moving. That was the winning move. That's what got him the gold medal. Fantastic sprint finish there for the minor medals. The UK guys just unluckily coming in fourth and fifth, but there was a massive group there and anyone could have had that medal.
Gérard Monnier, what a way to finish for the Frenchman. Two golds on the last day.
Oh, congratulations to the French, and a lovely tribute there as well with the pictures, wasn't it? Well, Prince Harry started the week reminding us just how important these games are in uniting the world after what so many people have gone through in the last few weeks. We saw what it meant to Team Ukraine to be here to represent their country, and of course, not surprisingly, the support for them at every event they've competed in has been incredible, hasn't it?
It's been amazing. And as this week of sport draws to a close, I caught up with the man who created these games to ask him about his hopes for the future and why this event is needed now more than ever.
Hi, nice to see you. Watch out, guys. Watch out, watch out. Hi, guys. Hi, how are you?
Oh, my God.
There you go. I'm here as well. How are you enjoying it? What's been a blast?
Look, the sitting volleyball, the wheelchair basketball, wheelchair rugby is always, without question, one of my personal favourites. This man in Orlando, I saw for the first time, I've never seen anyone hit a ball so straight down the fairway. Yeah, came all the way from New York to here.
Right.
Well done, guys.
We are staying all week.
Just staying all week. Fantastic.
What community you've built here?
It can't just be a community of service, friends and family. There has to be more to it than that. There has to be members of the public. There has to be that mixture.
And so how nervous were you about actually having these games come back and not just be the sport? Actually, we needed spectators, we needed family, we needed soul.
I think it was always, like for us, it was, the sport was, you know, from the beginning, we never knew what the sport was going to be like, yeah. Did we? We never knew how good it was going to be. And therefore, friends and family would always be there screaming and shouting no matter what the level or degree of the sport was. And then suddenly we're like, oh, wow, this is actually like a real thing. Like, the quality of sport is way better than we ever imagined.
But the quality is good because you're talking about, you know, individuals with serious drive, serious passion, but also because it's adapted, everybody's on a level playing field.
So many of us, so many individuals, so many people who are part of this game have experienced and continue to experience different varying degrees of trauma, right? Yeah. Whatever that is to them. If they've managed to get through it and they've recovered and they've come out on top, not just as an individual, but as a family, it is so relatable now for everybody around the world where war is being brought into your living room, and you don't have to be on a battlefield to experience trauma, right?
Yeah.
So what is it that the Invictus Games can now, having been through all of this, I guess, first, what is that? What can that community support system provide and show and teach members of the public from all across the world? I come for the sport. It's not about the medals. I'm not siding with any country or any nation here. As far as I'm concerned, as long as everyone's smiling, happy, and having a good time. And now that we're blessed with this weather all week, I mean, what more could we possibly ask for?
Listen, look at it. Smiles on everyone's faces. Right,
everyone seems happy.
Cheers, so man.
Did he buy you an ice cream?
Stroof waffles.
A stroof waffle. Say it properly, stroof waffle.
Oh, thank you.
They're very nice, very nice. Now, we know that Prince Harry and you, JJ, have a very close connection to the Games because you're both veterans of the conflict in Afghanistan.
Yeah, so many of the nations that are here, it is because of the bonds that were created as allies serving in different conflicts, but particularly Afghanistan and Iraq. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anyway, Prince Harry did his officer training at Sandhurst. It was there that he first met Team UK's Vicky Wales, a former physical training instructor who put him through his paces, but after an accident changed her life forever. It seemed a newfound passion for cycling is finally helping her move forward. Now, before we see her race, this is her story.
I'm Vicky Wales and I'm competing in the recumbent cycle for the UK Invictus team. It's like going 100 mile an hour in a go-kart. It was that feeling of being alive again and being thrilled at doing something physical that made me fall in love with it. In 2007, I had a life-changing accident. I was teaching an advanced physical combat march and I came off the back of a tailgate, which is around 6 foot, and landed on my back. Winded myself at the time, didn't think anything of it, really. I got sent to the hospital for some scans and they revealed that I'd fractured my spine in two places and I'd slipped three discs as well. That injury ended life as I knew it, really. It was difficult mentally. I should have probably got help at the time, to be honest with you, but being a typical soldier, you just brush it off and try and put your best foot forward. I didn't know what the future held, and it was just lots of uncertainty at the time. Being part of the team has helped mentally because we're all the same. We're all on the same journey no matter what life-limiting injury or illness that we've suffered. Because of that, I've got a new family. That's how I look at them lot. The future holds fun, passion, and just getting out there again. I've found the piece to the puzzle, if that makes sense.
The final of the women's IREB1 road race featuring from the United Kingdom number 70, Denise Kidger, and Victoria Wales wearing 77. And it's the Australian, Kerry Tessier, who is first to break here.
Yep, having two ladies in the UK team, they should work together, try and stay there, work together, try and fight off the other two, work as a team all the way around, and hopefully they can come away with two medals.
So Kerry Tessier of Australia and Beth King of the United States of America have now opened up a sizable lead over the United Kingdom's Victoria Wales, who's back in third. Steve Arnold, Victoria Wales looking pretty strong here.
Yeah, she's looking really good here. She's been on her own for quite a while. Obviously, the two up front moved off from the start and she's been in no man's land for a while, but she's working hard and keeping that third place going. Hopefully she can bring it home for that bronze medal.
So Denise Kidger has been lapped by
Kerry Tessier of Australia and Beth King from the USA, and they've all stopped for a chat and to help Denise Kidger along. Spirit of Invictus on display right here. The Zuider Park really is the most perfect setting to host the Invictus Games. All the facilities enclosed within the boundaries of this beautiful wide open space. Kerry Tessier pulling away now from Beth King. They've been side by side throughout, but now Tessier's going for goal. Oh, that's an amazing burst of speed from Kerry Tessier. She's been alongside Beth King and they've been chatting and joking for much of the race, but now we're down to the business end of things and Tessier wants the win.
Tessier, she's gone for it. She's put in the power, she's pulled the gap out, and hopefully she's got enough to hold it all the way to the end. But she's looking strong, she's looked strong all race, and I think this might be the winning move to win the gold medal.
It's a fast finish from Kerry Tessier. She's had a great Invictus Games with success in the pool. She took gold in the time trial this morning. She's got a gold in the road race to add to her collection. Superb racing from the Australian. And the silver will go to Beth King, who was alongside Kerry Tessier for much of the race before Tessier pulled away from her.
Strong finish here from Beth King. Great race, held in there with Kerry all the way around to the last K or so, and coming in to get the silver medal.
And Victoria Wales is riding home for the bronze. She's exhausted after her efforts, but a bronze medal for Victoria Wales in the women's IREB1 final. The final of the men's IREB1 road race featuring two United Kingdom athletes. David Dewar wears 64. Daniel Tasker has number 76.
Looks like a strong start there from the American team. You've got Daniel in third place, just slotting in the behind there. Just trying to stay with the guys. Good place to be at the moment for the early start of the race.
So this is the battle for the bronze medal. Third position has been held pretty much throughout by Daniel Tasker, but Garrett Kawada of the USA is closing quickly. Meanwhile, this is the race for the gold medal position, and it's between the American Gregory Quarles and the Italian Carlo Calagni. And Calagni is slipstreaming behind the American and goes past him now. Daring move from Carlo Calagni.
It's been a great race between these two. It's been battling out, changing over from the front, working together real hard to get away from the rest of the races. But I think he's made his break here. He's going to go for the win.
And meanwhile, this race within a race continues. Garrett Kawada has cruised past Daniel Tasker now and might just steal that Invictus bronze from the 40-year-old former Royal Air Force Corporal. And now he can enjoy the moment, and Carlo Calagni cruises home for Invictus Gold. The Italian takes the title in the men's IREB1 road race. And Greg Quarles, who was sharing the lead for much of the race with Carlo Calagni, is in silver medal position. Silver medal for the American Greg Quarles. There's our champion, Carlo Calagni, catching his breath after a race in the wind. Looks like it'll be silver and bronze for the USA. The gold to Calagni from Italy, the silver to Quarles from the USA, and the bronze to Garrett Kawada, with a brave finish from Daniel Tasker coming home to take fourth position in the Invictus Games IREB1 road race.
There you see Carlo come over the line, taking the gold medal, winning it for Italy. What a great race. Perfect tactics by him. Knew what he wanted to do. And there it is. That happy moment. First place.
Well, fresh from her bronze medal, I'm delighted to say that Vicky Wales joins us in the studio along with teammates Sally Raynard and Claire Keating. Welcome, ladies. Good to see you. Really good to have you. And literally fresh from winning that medal that's hanging around your neck. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Now, what you said to me just before we came onto set was it was a lot more emotional than you thought. Can you describe the moment for us?
Yeah, I didn't expect it, to be honest with you. I think I've had events every single day, so it's a build-up for me. And I didn't expect the release to be just as it was, but it was an amazing moment. Crossing that finish line, it was just the whole weight of the world off my shoulders.
Lovely.
I crossed it holding the dab as well, which I've become quite famous around the team for that. But yeah, a really emotional moment. It was a great ending to an amazing experience.
Is it emotionally exhausting, the whole thing? Because as you said, you've been competing a lot.
Yeah.
And it's also going to support your competitors. There's a lot of highs and lows, isn't there? Does it leave you drained?
Absolutely. I hardly had anything left on that crit, so I wouldn't describe myself as fresh at all, to be honest with you. But yeah, it's a whole mix of emotions, a roller coaster of emotions, and I'm just proud of everyone. Really proud.
Sally, I mean, what a haul of medals that is. But you've always been incredibly sporty. You must have been devastated when you had your accident. You know, how has this changed? Like, how does it feel to have it back?
This week has done so much for my confidence. I went through a phase that I was almost afraid to do any sport. I always kept myself active, even after my accident and after my rehab and my recovery. But I was always watching behind me in case, because I was stopped from competitive and contact sport. So representing the RAF in triathlon was a definite no-no for me anymore, and that was the one thing that I loved doing. So I really was devastated because it was the one thing that kept me going. It was the one thing that I felt that I loved alongside my job. This week has given me that confidence to say, yes, I can do this. I can get back to doing what I loved. And there's no stopping me now. I've got that constantly.
Well, we'll see that.
And do you know what? We watched a little piece on you earlier in the week, and it was lovely because you were in the garden with the girls, and you've obviously spent a lot of time being a mum recently. But you just said, and I think a lot of mums, myself included, can really empathise that, you know, you want to be more than just mum, and you want to show them you can be more than just be the mum who plays with them in the garden.
Yeah.
Do you think you've achieved that after this week?
Oh, definitely, definitely. I mean, I'm 47 next month, there was a couple of girls from one of the other teams that was similar sort of age to me, and we said, we're doing this for the mums that have got young kids. I mean, mine are 5 and 8. And I just wanted to do something to make them really proud of me again, for them to look at mummy and say, look at my, that's my mum. And to hear them shouting on the sidelines has been the most, it's the most powerful feeling that you can feel as a mum, to hear your children shouting for you.
Yeah.
My husband always cheers for me, but to hear the girls cheering for me, it's, oh dear, it brings tears. It can bring really big tears to your eyes.
Claire, of course, your family's come out with you as well. I mean, your daughter's been nominated for a special award out here because she does so much work in the day-to-day life, sort of helping to look after you. What's it been like for her to come out here and be able to just enjoy this?
It's been really nice for her. She still asks me, is someone looking after you, Mummy? How are you getting home? Oh. But for her to see me pushing myself and succeeding has just been amazing. She keeps saying, I'm so proud of you, Mummy, for doing this and doing it for yourself. And I just feel like I've changed completely as a person.
She has a lot of responsibility for someone so young. Does she get to come here and just be a kid?
She does. She has completely, because, like I say, she knows I'm looked after, she knows I'm happy, she knows I'm more than capable of doing lots of things, and she's just a little 9-year-old girl who's here enjoying a swim in the pool and with Daddy and cheering Mummy on, which is most important.
Oh, and it was an eye condition, wasn't it, Claire, that stopped your career in its tracks?
Yeah.
You now do something completely different. How hard has that transition been then for you?
It's really hard to kind of find your place in the world and know your worth again, but my job doesn't define me. I am my own person, and I can put myself out there in sport, and doing this, doing what I do, has shown how strong that I am and that I can succeed and I will succeed.
Thank you so much to the three of you. Such an inspirational chat for lots of people watching at home tonight. Thank you.
Yeah, an absolute joy. Well, one of the sports that Claire was competing in was powerlifting, where she narrowly missed out on a medal. But just like the rowing, the powerlifting arena is not a place for the faint-hearted. As Stef Reid found out, you need a whole lot of courage, strength and determination.
Ladies and gentlemen, the bar is... Focus, you can feel the tension. This strategy paid off as he lifted himself into second place behind America's Jacob Cox. The gold medal stands at 125 kilos, so James would have to lift a personal best to take gold. But it wasn't to be.
No PBs today, but I came and did what I wanted to.
One of the biggest fields of the day was the men's midweight, and it was packed with powerhouses. UK's Gaz Hennis started his Invictus journey not being able to walk. Today, he smashed a PB, and everyone from Team UK was on their feet, including his mum, Anne. UK's Jonathan Platt was in the zone. Jonathan Platt has just come in and laid down the biggest lift of the day in round one, 175 kilos. But could anyone catch him? Jonathan Platt has just shot the stadium with a successful lift at 180 kilograms. And with his final lift, he sealed the gold. Were you being very strategic, or were you thinking, I'm just going to win this from the top?
Just win it from the top. Just put a number in, and people want to chase me and try to beat me. Good luck.
We had it all today. We saw emotion, we saw strength, we saw lives transformed. We saw the power of powerlifting.
Wow, it was so intense in there, the atmosphere. But the thing is, and you saw it with Sarah there particularly, if you can mentally deal with that situation, then you can pretty much do anything.
Well, that's what she said. I mean, some of you may remember she came in on Monday, didn't she? And she was very honest with us, but saying there, you know, she wasn't physically as strong as she wanted to be, but mentally she was happy with where she's got to, and that's brilliant, isn't it?
Yeah, really.
Brilliant. Now, there have been incredible scenes all week here in The Hague. One moment that really got me was seeing the Dutch wheelchair basketball player Jelle van der Steen. Now, he had an operation last week, but nothing was going to stop him supporting his teammates. There he is, look, in his hospital bed. And that's the thing, it's all about making the impossible possible, and that is such testament to that, isn't it?
Yeah, what a touch. Well, there's such amazing camaraderie here at the Invictus Games, and here is the UK's vice-captain, Kelly Leonard, to tell us why it's so important to the wheelchair basketball team.
Wheelchair basketball.
We're down!
Try and get as many baskets as you can.
Swish!
Five people on the court.
Go, go, Vicky!
And we've got to stop them.
Yes, Luke!
Very fast-paced game. I tend to be able to get down to the D, tend to be able to get into the D, but I just like to defend people out, stop them transitioning down the court, really. Gwyn's great. I mean, he's a fellow Welshie. He's very good, very quick in the chair. He's a very good shooter. And is really good at getting somebody else into the key, so he's not a selfish player in any way. He really works the team well.
Getting back to doing a team sport and having that bond and that cohesion with people, that was my goal, and that's what I've got, so I've achieved my goal. If we medal, absolute bonus.
Tom, who is the captain of the basketball team, is amazing. He's quite understated as a person. He's not mostly outspoken, but you know that he's got your back wherever you go. Vicky is like my wingman. We've been through this journey, the whole journey together. I kind of migrate to Vicky very much. She's very much the support network for me within this team. Chris, he's a gentle giant. He's quite intimidating because he's so tall, and when he's in the chair, he still looks like he's stood up, but we love him for it. Dave Anderson is also on the rugby team. He'll kill me for saying this, the daddy of the group in the sense of, you know, he's calming.
It took us a while to come together as a team, But now, yeah, we couldn't be closer.
Paul's ex-Marine. He's very good on his ball handler. He's very swift. He does a lot of outside play as well.
I think we're well balanced, which is what you want just before the games. I think we're peaking at the right time.
Coach Scott, he's been with Invictus from the start. He was the first wheelchair basketball coach with Invictus.
When you get to that three, call it off, move out, reset, come back. We're certainly going to be one of the fittest teams there. I think we're going to be one of the tightest bonded teams there. And if we can make it happen at the right time, there's a possibility of walking away with gold.
Everyone's on their own journey through this. We don't generally know everyone's backstory, but that doesn't matter because there's no questions, there's no judgments, and we're all in this together. It's just having fun and being as aggressive as you could normally be on a normal pitch. It's wonderful.
Well, although Team UK were defeated by a tough Dutch side in their pool match, it didn't stop their journey to the semi-finals.
Yeah, they played the USA to decide whether they'd be going for gold or bronze. But I'm afraid the Americans were just too strong for Team UK. They really are the dominant team of the competition, beating the UK by 46 points to 13.
Yeah, shame that. In the other semi-final, the Netherlands beat Georgia 36 points to 14. So here's how the teams line up for the medal matches. The host nation, the Netherlands, face the defending champions, USA.
But first, let's find out how Team UK did in the bronze medal match against Georgia. Ronald McIntosh and former GB wheelchair basketballer Claire Griffith were in the commentary box. We join it as the UK lead 20 points to 13.
So to the free throw line, Anisha Jugeli, the man who has got 11 of Georgia's 13 points, looking to add two more.
And that's an unusual miss from him. He's been very effective from the free throw line today, which has meant that fouling him has really punished the UK team.
So 0 of 2 from the free throw line, but gets his own offensive rebound, pulls the trigger straight away. Rebound secured by Meluish. And it's an uncontested layup opportunity, which is duly drilled home by Victoria Ross. Victoria Ross moving to 10 points in the game.
Victoria Ross has had a massive impact in this second half.
Both teams finishing second in their respective groups. Georgia started out losing their opening game against the USA 31-8 before back-to-back victories, 17-3 against Ukraine and 23-13 against France, and they get the roll there to end a run of unanswered points from the UK.
That was a really nice cut through the key there by Kozrova, and it's taking the layup off an angle. It's a tough shot to take when you're turning your body back, especially towards the arm that you're shooting with.
Terrific finish from down in the low post from Gogita. Kozrova needs the once again back-to-back buckets off a fantastic feed from the wing from Safarov. Oh, how about that for using the window creatively? Terrific touch from Anthony Young. Geometric genius beneath the backboard.
Oh, that was wonderful from Anthony Young. Every single millimetre of that backboard got used just to drop it back down into the basket.
Well, that breaks a run of four unanswered points that Georgia put on the board to get to within five. But it's this man who has been doing the damage. Can't find a range, gets his own offensive rebound. How about that for a fantastic play for Gogita Kozrevaninza. 6 points in a row from the man who had 25 points for Georgia across the three pool matches.
Yeah, Kozrevaninza has been so influential to Georgia across this tournament, but in the first half, we didn't really see him scoring for them. Suddenly, he's come to life, he's getting himself in good positions, and he's making tough shots.
Tough shots indeed. His team back to within five. No, it took a while for the score graphic to tick over. Oh, and he's got the range in the hot hand. 8 points in a row for Gogita Kozrevaninza. And he is single-handedly keeping Georgia in contention in this bronze medal match. Just less than 5 minutes to play. It's a one-score game. 3 points the advantage for Team UK. Georgia hanging tough. It is Gogita Kozrevaninza who has been red hot. But how about that? The point guard coming to the point scoring party. terrific stroke from Ahmed Safarov to bring his team back to within one.
Something I love about the game of basketball is this shift in momentum. You can have a big lead and you get a few baskets and suddenly the runs with the other team, you can see such a shift in these performances from these teams. The team from the UK, suddenly their confidence have dipped. They're not taking the same shots. They've not got the patience in their offense. And the Georgian team are just saying, I'm going to take anything, and they're all going to go in.
Basketball is a game of runs, of course. And it's how you withstand that rally. UK came out blazing in the second half to go up by 9 at 13-22. But since that time, it has been a 10-2 run for Georgia. Off the mark, first of all, was Paul Gray, but then the ball's still loose on the inside, and we've got a foul committed, which will send UK to the free throw line. Ahmed Safarov committing the foul. So it's Kelly Leonard on the free throw line. Just composing herself ahead of this second effort. Battle for the boards will be important in the event that it rims out, as it does. And it's a strong defensive rebound secured by Gogita Kozrevanidze. What a lead pass. And now Ahmed Safarov in the open court. He goes cross court to the man who has had the hot hand for Georgia in the second half. Kozrevanidze inside. And the shooter's roll favors the speedster, Ahmed Safarov. And it's Georgia who have taken a one-point lead as they continue to ride this wave of momentum.
They need a score to stay in this game now, Team UK.
Well, when you're playing a basketball game without a running clock, this portion of the game is known as crunch time. And it's where the major players step to the fore, not just in terms of point scoring, but making plays. Field goal attempt from the top of the key from Ahmed Safarov. Tony Young gets it over the halfway line. Falwell coming down this left side. He's met by Safarov. Victoria Ross strokes it beautifully to put her team up by one, ending a run of 8 unanswered points stitched together by Georgia. And look at the difference in emotion on the faces of the fans waving the Georgian flag.
Great composure at that point. Sometimes it takes a team to be down to find that way of playing again.
And it's a one-point game. Victoria Ross with a strong reception. Tom Falwell comes to relieve her of the basketball. He keeping the ball in his hands. Field goal attempt is off the mark, and he's saying, well, I've been fouled. The official perfectly placed and not interested. No whistle forthcoming.
No, and Tom had to put that shot up because there was only 3 seconds on the shot clock there.
So the clock continuing to tick, remember, a rolling clock. Georgia need a miracle three-pointer, but they've turned the basketball over. And Team UK, there's a foul, but the clock will expire, and that is it. The celebrations might just be a little bit premature because the trip to the free throw line forthcoming for Team UK. So, 2 free throws to come for Tom Falwell, the Team UK basketball captain. 2 seconds have been put on the clock, so Georgia, the required possession and a miracle. It's vital that Team UK remain concentrated. And you see captain's instructions being issued by Falwell, former sapper in the UK Army. Well, it's almost as though Georgia stopped playing. The clock didn't start, and now it does, and that offensive rebound secured. And there is the final buzzer, which sees Team UK prevail over Georgia in a one-score game, which was absolutely thrilling. And this means the world to the Team UK veterans out on the court for the 3rd successive edition of the Invictus Games. They return to the bronze medal podium, but Georgia deserve immense credit for the battle they put forth to make this the thrilling spectacle that we've just enjoyed.
What an incredible match, and well played, Team UK, to take the bronze. Now, meanwhile, in the gold medal match, no surprise to see it was a runaway victory for the United States over the Netherlands. Tremendous scenes in the Invictus Games Stadium. And after they'd collected their medals, a few members of Team UK's wheelchair basketball team came to join us in the studio. Well, a big welcome to basketball captain Tom Folwell, Vicky the Boss Ross, and Paul Gray. Welcome, guys. Good to see you.
Thanks for having us.
Again, a great collection of medals. Congratulations. But for you then, Tom, captain of the wheelchair basketball, wheelchair rugby. We know you had a silver in the wheelchair rugby and a bronze in the wheelchair basketball. How do you feel as captain? You must be supremely proud of your team.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, it's been a privilege over the last 2.5 years to share the journey with these guys. It's just been amazing.
But you guys know how to put on a show. I mean, that wheelchair rugby final was end-to-end, and that basketball, like, down to the buzzer. Yeah. I mean, that is as good a game of basketball as you would watch anywhere. Did you expect it to go that way? And, like, how was it just holding out, even?
I don't really know, to be honest. She got the final points.
Yeah, and that was it. Like, I mean, what an amazing thing, as I say, holding that nerve and getting that final point. How did that feel?
It was good. It was a nice little bit of revenge from the same volleyball, but it was nice. It was nice to help my teammates get a medal for those who have only played team sports, so it was really good.
Yeah. Now, it's been a long journey to The Hague for all of you competitors taking part. For you, Vicky, the thing that you've struggled with over the years is your identity and confidence. Now, how much does sitting here with those medals help that recovery?
Yeah, it has helped. So being part of the process, it actually gave me enough confidence to go and ask for some mental health help. So I've received my diagnosis. So I'm still early in my journey, but I can see a light, you know, at the end of a tunnel now. So I am moving forward. And just to share it with people like Tom and Paul is absolutely priceless. It literally does mean the world to me.
I mean, Vicky, we've seen you everywhere this week, and one thing that's so clear from watching you compete is you wear your heart on your sleeve and you care about the people around you. I remember when you came off the rower, I could see the emotion on your face about what it meant to you. I mean, what does it mean to you? How have the emotions been this week? Because it's a lot.
It's been a massive roller coaster for many different reasons. Like you mentioned about the rowing. So for me, that's been a big demon of mine because of my PTSD. It involves not being able to breathe and feeling like I can't breathe. So to actually get on and complete 4 minutes, never mind win the gold medal, you know, and it's massive. So that's a big accomplishment for me to do that.
So even just getting to the rower in the first place is the accomplishment.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, not that I did a little training, but I did a little rowing specific training. I bought a rowing machine, but it stayed in the shed because it just holds so much fear for me. But I managed to do it here and get a PB and fortunately enough to get a gold medal as well.
And Paul, you say that the lovely thing about being in Team UK is the fact that you're in a team where you're not judged, but you're understood. How has that helped you and how important is that then to you all?
It's been massive. To play alongside people that are inspirational to me, like Vicky and Ross and the whole of the Team UK, it means a massive amount because I'm early in my journey with my mental health. Physically, I'm starting to manage my arthritis, but I took a downward spiral in my mental health later on, almost like a delayed reaction. Mm. But to see people like-minded would come back from where I feel like I was. It's been a massive help. And not to feel judged, like you said, when I talk about it, because it's always that mindset of, especially as a male and a Marine, it's you don't want to say that you need help up here. It's really hard to admit it, but it's such a release to admit it to these guys. And that has then inspired me to then take it and go and see the mental health team through Help for Heroes, the Hidden Wounds team, which is now starting to get me back on track.
Wow. Well, and Paul, the fact that you're sitting here telling everybody at home about that as well is incredible. Thank you so much, Vicky. I hope your voice comes back.
Yes, sir.
See? Very enthusiastic competitor. Thank you. Thank you.
I doubt her voice is going to come back because the team joined us a little earlier because they are in the main arena now at the closing ceremony. And we'll have full coverage of that on BBC iPlayer at 8:30.
And we really have to say, don't we, a huge thank you to every single competitor who's joined us in the studio because they've been so generous in sharing their stories, so honest. They've really spoken from the heart, which has not been easy for them.
Yeah, but the thing is, you know, this Games does change the life of the competitors, of the friends and family, but them sharing their stories changes the life of people sitting watching this right now, and that is why this is so important. We've had a roller coaster of emotions. It has just been incredible.
Yeah, it really has. Well, joining us now to reflect on these Games and beyond is Paralympian and reporter Stef Reid. Hiya, Stef. You look like you've had a brilliant week. I've seen you out and about. She's always at some competition or another. Oh, yeah. Has it been brilliant?
I have had the best time, not only at the competitions, but also at the festival going on behind us.
I know. Love it. I know. Everything's come together this week somehow, hasn't it? And we mentioned the closing ceremony is happening now. They've handed the flag over to the next host city. What can you tell us?
Well, we know the next city will be Dusseldorf, and it's going to be in September 2023. And this is super exciting because so many of the competitors have said how watching the Games and seeing people just like them compete gave them the courage to then apply. And word is getting out about the spirit of these Games. Over 90% of Team UK, it was their first time, and we're going to see a whole new set of competitors and stories in 2023.
And there's been some more exciting news today as well. Yes. Check this out.
I'm thrilled to announce that the Invictus Games Foundation has selected Canada to host the first ever Winter Hybrid Games in 2025.
Steph, Canada, we know you love it. And a Hybrid Games, how exciting is it to be heading over to Vancouver?
I mean, this is big news. When he says Hybrid Games, what Prince Harry means is that for the first time, we are going to see winter adaptive sport.
Amazing.
So it's going to be split between Vancouver and Whistler. In terms of winter sports, we're going to see alpine skiing, Nordic skiing, wheelchair curling, and skeleton. I mean, the name says it. The most dangerous one you can think of. And that's going to be super exciting because, one, it's just showing that the Invictus Games, it's growing, it's evolving, but also it's going to give athletes with different skill sets the chance to shine.
Yeah, and different passions, yeah.
That is definitely something to look forward to in 2025. But let's, for a minute, look back at the phenomenal week that it's been here in The Hague. For you, favourite moment, if you can pick one?
I mean, it's tough because there's so many, but the standout moment for me was, it was Vicky Ross, when she, it was the start of the endurance race for the women's IR6, and I could see from where I was, there was something going on. It looked to me like the start of a panic attack, and she mentioned in the interview afterwards that she wanted to leave, she didn't want to be there, and you could see it was her teammates that were talking her through it, encouraging her to breathe, reminding her of all the training, and not only did she stay on the floor and compete, she smashed it, and to watch someone overcome their fear, for me, it just reminded me that we all can do that.
Absolutely. It's nearly impossible to pick your favourite. It's like choosing a favourite child.
Well, I'm going
to
make you.
But if I had to, I'd go probably Lisa Johnston coming over the line after the 400 metres. It was obviously a huge struggle for her, but she pushed through it and then was greeted by her family and her children. Well, and that was it. I was gone, everybody, on the floor, drowning in my own tears. Happy tears, but it was such a great moment, wasn't it?
I think Gwyn Walker, for me, we had him in the studio
and he
shared, you know, the struggles of his mental health so passionately because he wanted to help others watching it. But then you see, as you see a different person sat here struggling, as you see out in the basketball court, he's just, you know, he's incredible. Look at him. And that's the secret here. It's trying to make sure that Gwyn, who looks like a different person, is the person that wakes up on Monday and goes on to do something amazing.
Oh, we enjoyed meeting Gwyn. And as you say, the transformation is incredible. You can't believe in the space of a week how far he's come. But what a brilliant week we've had. The people of the Netherlands have been such wonderful hosts, so warm. From the atmosphere to the competitors and the sport, the memories of these Games will really stay with us.
Yeah, like we said, thank you to everyone who has shared their stories, and thank you to you for watching.
The closing ceremony is coming up now on BBC iPlayer. So from all of the team, goodbye, and we will see you in Düsseldorf.
Good night,
everybody. Thank you for watching. Bye.
Invictus, are you ready?
Falling too fast to prepare for this. Tripping in the world could be dangerous. Everybody circling as vultures. Negative, nepotist. Everybody waiting for the fall of man. Everybody praying for the end of times. Everybody hoping they could be the one. I was born to run, I was born for this. Whip,
run me like a race. What an Invictus Games moment for Lisa Johnston.
And they win it with an ace. Poland are the champions. The atmosphere is incredible.
She said more than anything else, she wants her children to be proud of her.
Concentration. Goal, celebration, Sherry McBain.
A magnificent sprint treble for the man from Belfast.
Three Invictus golds in the pool for Rachel Williamson. Whatever it takes, I love you. We've had a flood of Invictus medals for the UK swimmers.
That's huge from Shane Russell.
The United States are the champions.
This means the world to the Team UK veterans. I'll do what it takes.